Hello and welcome to Holy Impact Ministries Bible Study Night. I'm Pastor Scott Villane with HolyImpactMinistries.com. God bless you and thank you for sharing your time with us here on our Wednesday night Bible study that we have. Try to get these up and posted right about 8 o'clock every Wednesday night. If you'd like to join us every Wednesday night, you can visit us at HolyImpactMinistries.com and simply go to our Bible study tab, and you'll be able to get the video right there. We will probably move into doing our Wednesday night Bible studies live, and I think next week may be the first week that we will do the Wednesday night Bible studies live, and we will probably start them at about 7 p.m. instead of 8. So we're going to back them up about an hour and actually try and do them live, and I think this will be a lot more interesting for everyone, I think. But this is the first chapter of the book of Acts. Now, if you have not seen the introduction to the book of Acts, please watch that video first. We want to encourage you to watch that because there is some information there that we're not going to repeat here this evening. So getting right into it, understanding the book of Acts is paramount. If we're going to understand the gospel message of our Messiah, the concepts that we will be introduced here in the book of Acts are numerous. We'll be introduced to the act of baptism. We'll be introduced to the Holy Spirit and the obedience of faith. We'll be introduced to Paul and the many different audiences that Paul had, the circumcision group, the Gnostics, witchcraft, astrology, and so on and so forth. We'll be introduced to James and the Jerusalem Council in Acts 15. We'll also be introduced to the fulfillment of many different prophecies that were listed in the Torah, in the Old Testament, as some call it, that point right to and are shadow pictures of what we are reading here in the book of Acts. Now, I just want to make this understood again. This book of Acts, it was actually one work that was penned by the physician Luke. And we touched on this a little bit during our introductory course to the book of Acts. The book of Luke and the book of Acts was one work, and it was entitled History of Christian Origins. So the two books were one. There wasn't a separate book called Luke and then another one called the Acts of the Apostles. It was a single book with two volumes. And, of course, we know that these books became separated a little bit after about 64 AD, after the physician Luke had penned them. So we're going to talk a little bit about that, and I want us to just kind of keep that in mind. The book of Luke, the book of Acts, was one book at one time originally. And again, it was entitled History of Christian Origins. So just kind of keep that in the back of your mind as we progress here. If we misunderstand one of these concepts that we're going to be looking at in the book of Acts, we will be far off the mark when it comes to properly understanding the rest of the New Testament writings and the very foundation of the gospel message that our Messiah fought and even died for to deliver to us. So it is extremely important that we take our time with this, and take our time we will. Paul's teaching, the Apostle Paul's teaching, bar none, are the greatest influence in today's modern-day version of Christianity. Now, the following is a breakdown of the letters that Paul wrote and the time frames that he had written them in. And I want to take you over to those. Let me see if I could pull a list of these books up for you so that we have them for you to take a look at. And let me fix this picture for us here real quick. There we go. Of course, Paul was responsible for writing 13 different books out of the 27 books of the New Testament. He wrote Galatians, he wrote 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Corinthians and Romans, Ephesians, Philemon, Colossians, the Philippians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, and Titus as well. And there is some discrepancy or whether over the book of Hebrews, whether he actually wrote that or not, or was it Peter that possibly wrote that? So possibly 14 books. And of course, we have the book of Luke and we have the book of Acts, even though they were not penned by Paul, he did not write them. We know that the writings of Paul and the sayings of Paul and what he was saying are documented in these books as well. So Paul takes up about two-thirds of the book of the New Testament. And it's very interesting to know and to understand this. We need to know and understand if we get the writings of the Apostle Paul wrong, we, again, are going to be way off the mark in understanding what the true gospel message is. So we want to be very careful about that. So in the end, we find almost two-thirds of the New Testament was either written directly by Paul or were about Paul and his teachings. And we'll see through the book of the apostles that Paul did not have the final word on matters concerning the gospel. This is very important for us to know and to understand. Let me say that again. Paul did not have the final word on matters concerning the gospel. And we'll see this as we move through the 15th chapter of Acts, where James, the brother of Yeshua, who was the head of the Jerusalem council, makes a judgment concerning putting forth a decree concerning circumcision. And that's what chapter 15 is all about. It's about this big debate about the circumcision group telling people that you got to get circumcised right now, or you're not saved, and there, you can't qualify for the salvation provided by our Messiah. And this was a big debate that was going on, and we'll get to that. That's in the 15th chapter. So my point is that we need to know and understand as we progress through the book of Acts that Paul actually goes to James and the elders, at the, who is the brother of Yeshua, and he is the president of the Jerusalem Council, for more clarification on the gospel message concerning circumcision. Now, with that being said, it's important to understand the Apostle Peter. Now, we talked a little bit in our introduction to the book of Acts how Peter and Paul had done a lot of things alike in their journeys in setting up these new churches and helping people to know and to understand what the gospel message of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ our Messiah, really was. Peter, the differences between the two men, and this is a distinction that we need to make, Peter sat at the feet of our Messiah. He was with him the years that he taught. He lived with them. He heard the things that he said. Paul, on the other hand, was kind of a Johnny-come-lately, if you will. He was not one of the 12 apostles, okay, originally. It wasn't until later, after Judas had betrayed our Messiah, and then we had to have a 12th apostle, that Paul was added. So it's important for us to know this. Now, again, Peter, knowing and understanding who Yeshua was, lived with him, understood what he was talking about, heard him speak directly, has a little bit of a problem with the writings of the Apostle Paul. And I want to show this to you. I think you'll find this very interesting. Peter, who sat at the feet of Yeshua, said this about the Apostle Paul. Now, let's go over here very quickly, and we'll take a look at this. This is 2 Peter 3:16. And let me, I think I'll take us over to the English Standard Version. I think I have that highlighted. 2 Peter 3:16. And let's just kind of go through this. Peter says this. He says, "There are some things in them," speaking about the writings of Paul, "that are hard to understand, which the ignorant and the unstable will twist to their own destruction, as they do the other scriptures." So there are people, he's warning us, that are ignorant and unstable, who are going to twist the writings of the Apostle Paul to their own destruction. And he says, "You therefore, beloved, knowing this beforehand, take care that you are not carried away with the error of lawless people and lose your own stability." Now, this is an important warning that we receive from Peter, who again was originally one of the 12 apostles and was with Yeshua the whole time. Now, most of today's modern-day denominational charters of Christianity do not understand the writings of the Apostle Paul, because they, like Marcion of Sinope, who we've already discussed in the introduction series, do not take into consideration the Jewishness of Paul, or even our Messiah, for that matter. They don't want to be reminded of the Jewishness of Paul. And just like Marcion, we talked a little bit about Marcion of Sinope in about 440 A.D., who was trying to put together the first New Testament canon. You see, there was no New Testament for at least a century after our Messiah had been crucified. His death, burial, and resurrection had passed. It was a whole century before an actual canon of scriptures had been put together and called the New Testament. So all they had for that first century was the Old Testament, and these writings were being completed at that point in time. Now, Marcion of Sinope, who again we spoke about in our introductory series, he wanted to do away with the Jewishness of Paul in his canon. So what he did is he took the one book, remember, Luke and the Acts of the Apostle was one book. He took that one book and he separated it. And he took the book of Luke and he took about nine writings of the Apostle Paul, and he got rid of the book of Acts, and he got rid of the Torah and the Tanakh and anything else in the Old Testament. So, and this was going to be his New Testament Bible. And this is all there was going to be to this Bible. It was just going to be the book of Luke and about nine different writings from the Apostle Paul, void of the book of Acts, void of the Torah, void of this old Jewish God. You see, because as far as Marcion of Sinope was concerned, Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles, and he was starting a new Gentile church that replaced those old nasty Jews that hung Jesus on the cross. Sound familiar? Again, this seems to be one of the very first Christian denominations that was built around someone picking and choosing and cherry-picking scripture to their own destruction and turning that into a Christian denomination. And, of course, the bishops of the churches that Paul and the apostles worked so hard to set up completely threw a fit about this and said that Marcion of Sinope was a heretic, and they stopped him from doing this. So it didn't last very long. It was very short-lived. And again, we hear Tertullian, who was a historian back in those days, writing about Marcion and proclaiming, "You must tell us who Paul is. You must tell us how Paul became an apostle." And of course, without the book of Acts, you don't have any of that information. So this New Testament that Marcion wanted to put together didn't include the book of Acts. And this is where we find out where Paul comes from. Who is Paul? How did Paul become an apostle? All of these things come from the book of Acts. So again, it was very short-lived, but many Christian churches today, many Christian denominations still follow that train of thought. They don't like to admit the Jewishness of our Messiah, to understand that he came out of the house of David, from the tribe of Judah. He was a Jew, and it is the blood of a Jew that covers the transgressions of the whole world. And we can know that and understand that if we just read the text. And the apostles were all well aware of this. They knew that he came from the house of David. They knew that he came from the tribe of Judah. They knew he was the one that the Torah, the Old Testament, prophesied about. And they were expecting him to come back and to rule and reign right then and there. And they didn't exactly get what they thought was going to happen. In fact, they asked about this in the first chapter. We'll read about that. So the apostles themselves were a little confused about the mission of our Messiah. So, we see Paul quoting from scriptures. We see him always quoting from the Masoretic text. He doesn't quote from the Septuagint. And they are a little bit different in their wording. And so in the writings of the Apostle Paul, you can tell that he always quotes, when he quotes from the Torah or the Tanakh, he quotes from the Masoretic text, which tells us the Jewishness of Paul and exactly who he was. Again, Paul being a Benjamite who came out, who was part of the southern kingdom. Remember, there was the northern kingdom, the 10 tribes of Israel were up north, And then you had the Benjamites, what was left of them, and the Judeans down the bottom, which was the southern kingdom. Of course, Paul came from the southern kingdom of Judah. So he was a Pharisee. So we know that Paul was a Pharisee. And he came, he was very, very Jewish. He knew the Torah. He had committed it to memory. He sat at the feet of Gamaliel. He knew at least four different languages that we know of. A highly educated man was Paul. Now, people who have never heard the gospel message, you know, who have never understood the Torah or the customs or the laws or the precepts or the commandments handed down by Yahweh or Elohim, are completely new. And this is just some of the people I want to talk a little bit about, some of the people that were in Paul's audience. And again, some of the people that were in his audience were absolutely new. They knew nothing about the laws, nothing about the precepts. They just went to work. They did their business. They just wanted to feed their kids. They weren't into astrology. They weren't into any certain type of religion. They were just normal people, and they were sitting in the audience, and Paul was trying to reach them. Again, they heard these stories of the Messiah. They heard the stories of the apostles walking through the land and healing people and proclaiming this new gospel, and they were the light. And the people of that day, many of the people of that day, saw the light of these men and were drawn to the light. They were drawn to the truth. So we had some people that were just Gentiles. They weren't Jews at all. They were just normal people, and they heard this gospel message, and they were flocking to it. So we had these people in his audience. On the other side of the coin, they had those that were well entrenched in the Torah, also known as the law, by the way. And you'll see that the law and the Torah are often interchanged. And in many different Bible versions, instead of saying Torah, they'll say law, Torah. They are very well interchanged. If you ask a Jewish man to read something out of the law for you, he would grab the Torah and the Tanakh, and he would know exactly what you were talking about. So the problem is that these people that were very well entrenched in the Torah, many of them were Pharisees. And the problem is, if we get into the 23rd chapter of Matthew, and I encourage you to read the 23rd chapter of Matthew, you will see the contention that our Messiah had for these Pharisees, because they were overriding the laws of our Messiah, or our Father in Heaven, Yahweh, our Elohim. The laws that he had commanded them, they were overriding, and they were writing their laws on top of his commandments. And that's why our Messiah said, "You have made void the word of God in order to hold on to your own traditions." And he was extremely upset with them. And if you read down the 23rd chapter of Matthew, you find our Messiah calling them several names, like, "You whitewashed tombs, you blind guides, you brood of vipers." He said, "You travel over land and sea to make one proselyte, and when you do, he's a twofold child of hell, more so than yourself." So he had much contention for these Pharisees that Paul had to deal with. Now he's gone, and Paul has to deal with them. And so we have those people who are very well entrenched in the law, but they are confused because the Pharisees and the scribes had all these other man-made laws that they had put over top of the Torah that the apostles and our Messiah was trying to break through. We also had people who were by blood part of the lost sheep of Israel, okay? By blood, they were Israelites, but they had lost their Jewishness because they were in the process of being dispersed into the four corners of the earth. And these were the people that our Messiah came for. He said very, very clearly, he said, "I have come for the lost sheep of Israel. That's who I have come for." He had to put the two sticks of Ezekiel back together into one stick. He had to recoalesce the olive tree, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, back into one olive tree so that the rest of the nations of the world could be grafted into that one olive tree, into the body of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. This is what he came for, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. And then the fourth type of person that he had in the audience was probably someone who was steeped into all kinds of things like Gnosticism and Epicureanism and Platonism and worshiping the divisions, these different gods, Zeus and Dionysus and all of these different things. They were worshiping the stars, the sun, the moon. They had their own feast days and their own holidays and things that they kept and their own Sabbaths that they kept. And so we need to know and understand that there was many of those people as well that were sitting in the audience of Paul. So Paul had to kind of change gears, and he had to change his mentality as to how he was talking and how he was speaking to these people. He wasn't going to speak to the Pharisees the same way that he was going to speak to the Gnostics, and he wasn't going to speak to the greenhorns the same way that he was going to speak to the Pharisees, who already had the law and knew the law. Okay, so we need to kind of keep that in mind in order to understand the context upon what Paul was trying to say at these different places that he went to. Now, talking once again about the contention that Yeshua had, again, read Matthew 23 for yourself, just that chapter, and you'll see all of the contention that they had. I want to take you to, very quickly, let's take you to Matthew 5:20 here. I think I have that bookmarked. Yes, right down here at the bottom. This is what our Messiah says, or our Messiah tells us. He says, "For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Now, this is pretty strong words coming from our Messiah. So we need to kind of understand the context of the message, the gospel message that is being delivered here. Much of today's modern-day version of Christianity is in line with the with Marcion of Sinope and the way that he used to think, that the Jewishness of Christianity should be all but forgotten and removed from the teachings of the gospel and from our Messiah and from Paul. And in many churches will tell you, and in fact, the Roman Catholic Church is famous for proclaiming that you can't understand the scriptures for yourself. Only the hierarchy of the church can. And you shouldn't even read that Old Testament. That's not for you, you see, because only we can understand it. And many Christian denominations will tell you that, that the Old Testament really doesn't mean anything. It's just a little bit of a history, how things progressed a little bit, but that's all dead and gone away with. It's all been nailed to the cross, and that we don't need to pay any attention to it. So most Christians don't, and they don't read the first half of the book. So they only have half of the story because they have been conveniently programmed by Christian academia not to really be so concerned with that dusty old Testament. And this is exactly what Marcion of Sinope was trying to do. And of course, the church elders and the bishops of that time stopped him from doing this. But we see that bleeding through even today in today's modern day version of Christianity. And this is why we need to be so very, very careful. Now, it's important, as I take the time to teach this study, that I do not allow us to be ignorant or to be unstable so that we twist the writings of the Apostle Paul or what we're reading about Paul to our own destruction. And that's our objective here today as we move into the first chapter of the book of Acts, to not be looking at the scriptures in the wrong context, to put them in the proper light, and to know and understand that this is a continuation of the Old Testament. There is really no Old and New Testament. It is one testament, and it all flows nicely together. It is one story, one testament, one Bible is what it is. And those who call it the Old Testament and the New Testament just lend credence to the idea that it's the New Testament is so much different and separate and apart from the Torah. We're going to find out that that is not true. That is not what our Messiah said, and it is not what the apostles said either. So we're going to be very careful to make sure that we know and understand what we're seeing in the book of Acts is a continuation of what we have seen in the Torah. And many of the prophecies in the Torah and the Tanakh, the Old Testament, are being fulfilled in the book of Acts. And we need to know that. We need to understand this. So, as we've told you earlier, the book of Luke and the book of Acts was one work. It was one book that the physician Luke penned. Okay, he put them together as one book. They were not two books. But however, and it was called History of Christian Origins. However, it got separated right about Marcion's time because a lot of people liked Luke, but the book was so lengthy that they didn't, they'd stop at Luke and they were happy with that, and they didn't really read the rest of the book of Acts. So when it got separated at that time, more people knew the book of Acts, or I'm sorry, more people knew the book of Luke than did the book of Acts. The book of Acts almost fell away. And in fact, I just want to read to you this from a historian by the name of John Christendom, who lived around 400 A.D. And he wrote this. Let me pull this up here for you because I have this. I wanted you to see this. Here it is right here. And we'll take a look at what he wrote. Very important. Again, this is from John Christendom, and he lived right about 400 A.D. And he says this. He says, too many people, this book, the book talking about the book of Acts, both its content and its author, is so little known that they are not even aware that it exists. I have therefore taken this narrative for my subject, both to initiate those who are ignorant and so that such a treasure shall not remain hidden out of sight. So again, John Christendom, along with many of the church bishops, fighting to keep the other part of Luke's writings in the New Testament writings. So they were fighting to keep the book of Acts alive because a lot of people, they were pushing the book of Luke, but not pushing the book of Acts. And the book of Acts was kind of falling back by the wayside. And again, we see the historian Tertullian writing about this Marcion who was trying to erase the book of Acts. And he kind of scolds him. And he says to Marcion, he says, you must show us who Paul is. You must show us how he became an apostle in the first place. You must show us his history. So Tertullian, again, another one, apart from John Christensen, or Christensen, Chrysostom, try and say that three times fast, John Chrysostom, Tertullian and Chrysostom felt the same way about this, what Marcion was trying to do in separating these two books. And I find it extremely interesting that around 400 A.D., which is right around the same time of Marcion, we have John Chrysostom telling us that the book of Acts, he says, he said it is so little known that they're not even aware that it exists in the early church. And so we should be very, very, very thankful that we do still have the book of Acts to take a look at. Now, with this in mind, I just want to ask you this question before we get too much further. Do you suppose when we look at our New Testament, we have Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and then we have the book of Acts? Why don't we have Matthew, Mark, John, then Luke, then the book of Acts? Luke and the book of Acts were one work. Why did they separate, knowing this? Why did they separate Luke from the book of Acts? Do you think that there was a reason, an underlying reason as to why they did that? I believe that there absolutely was. And we'll talk a little bit about that a little bit later on. Just a little bit of food for thought. Now, the main thing that we need to understand is if they can paint Paul, okay, as a Reformed Jew, who is now preaching against the Jews, okay, and is establishing a new Gentile church in place of the Jews, okay, then this puts them and their denomination in charge, you see. If they can say, we Gentiles and our Gentile church has replaced the Jews and the Israelites, you see, then this is a whole new religion. This is a whole separate and a whole new religion. And is not anything even close to what it's supposed to be. And people will just believe whatever the church says. And again, this is a Nicolaitan type of teaching where the hierarchy of the church is above the lay people. It's not meant to be that way. In the book of Ephesians, it tells us very clearly, and Paul tells us that he gave us pastors and teachers and priests to for the uplifting, for the building up of the church, not to dominate over the church. And this is where another area where Christianity has gone wrong. This is a Nicolaitan type of teaching. And if we read through the letters to the seven churches, we find that Yahweh God hates the way of the Nicolaitan. And this, again, is another whole teaching, but we could understand where this comes from. And again, read the book of Jude, and you'll know how many times we've been warned about these ungodly men coming into the church and making lasciviousness out of the gospel of our Messiah. And we're going to put all of that to rest as we go through the book of Acts in this first chapter. So we want to be very careful that we're not painting Paul as some kind of reformed Jew that's trying to do away with Yeshua's Jewishness and his own Jewishness. We know that Paul observed the law all the way through, and even unto his death he observed the law. Never preached against the law, and we know that, we can understand that. For those of you who have been through our teaching in the book of Romans, you already know that, and you're going to see that continuation here through the book of Acts. So, with that all being said, and that's a mouthful in itself, let's go take a look at the first chapter of the book of Acts, and let's just read through it. We're just going to read through it very quickly here. Okay, and let's do that. It says, Acts chapter 1, verse 1. In the first book, Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and to teach. Let me go over to, I'm going to use the, actually going to use the Hebrew Bible as we're reading through this. Acts 1, chapter 1. Indeed, O Theophilus, I made the first report concerning all things which Yeshua began to both do and to teach, until the day he was taken up, having given directions to the apostles whom he elected through the Holy Spirit, those who also to whom he revealed himself while alive after he suffered, with numerous signs for 40 days. He was being seen by them, and he spoke concerning the kingdom of Yahweh. Now, the kingdom of Yahweh, the kingdom of God, and the kingdom of heaven, again, are two interchangeable words that you can use. The kingdom of Yahweh is the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of Yahweh. It's the same. And while he ate bread with them, he charged them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait the promise of the Father, which you heard from me. For John indeed baptized in water. He's talking about Yochan, John the Baptist, okay? John indeed baptized in water. He says, but you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit not many days after. Then indeed, coming together, they questioned him, saying, Master, do you restore the kingdom to Israel at this time? Again, they're looking for the Messiah that was prophesied in the Torah to come. They knew that a Messiah was coming, but they're looking for this Messiah to come to free them from this Roman rule and to take control of the earth again, see, is what they're looking for. So they're asking him, they're saying, coming together, they questioned him and they said, Master, do you restore the kingdom to Israel at this time? And he said to them, it is not yours to know times or seasons which the Father placed in his own authority. But when the Spirit of holiness comes upon you, you will receive the power, and you will be witnesses of me both in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And saying these things, as they looked on, he was taken up in a cloud, and he was hidden from their sight. And as they were intently looking into heaven, he, having gone, even behold, two men in white clothing stood by them, who also said, Men, Galileans, why do you stand looking up into the heaven? This Yeshua, who has been taken up from you to heaven, likewise, he will come just as you have seen him, him who ascended into heaven. So in other words, just like he left, he will return. Then they returned to Jerusalem from the mount being called of Olive Grove, which is near Jerusalem, a distance of 7 furlongs away. And when they went in, they went up to the upper room where they were waiting. Both Peter and Jacob and John and Andrew, Philip, Thomas, Bartholomew, Matthew, Jacob, the son of Alphaeus, the son of Simon the Zealot, and Judas, the brother of Jacob. These all were continuing steadfastly in prayer and in supplication with one mind, with the women, and with Miriam, the mother of Yeshua, and his brothers. And in these days, standing up in the middle of the disciples, and the number of names together being about 120, Peter said, "Men, brothers, it is not necessary for this scripture to be fulfilled, which the Holy Spirit spoke before through David's mouth concerning Judas, the one having become guide to those seizing Yeshua. For he was numbered with us and obtained a portion of this ministry. This is he who obtained a field for himself from the reward of sin and fell upon his face on the ground and burst from his middle and poured out all of his insides. And it became known to all those living in Jerusalem, so as the field to be called in their own dialect, Ekledema, that is, the field of blood. Let this dwelling be desolate, and let not one be a dweller in it, and let another take his office. Therefore, it is right that men being together with us all the time in which the Master Yeshua came in and went out among us, beginning from the baptism of John until the day when he was taken from us, one of these to become a witness of his resurrection with us. And they set out two, Joseph being called Barsabbas, who was surnamed Justus, and Matthias. And having prayed, they said, You, Master, knower of all hearts, show which one you choose from these two, that they may receive a portion of the ministry and the apostleship from which Judas departed, that he might go to in his place. And they gave their lots. They were casting lots now to replace Judas. And the lot fell on Matthias, and he was numbered with the 11 apostles. Okay, so a lot of information in this first chapter. Now, hopefully you've read the first chapter for yourself. If not, I encourage you to go back over this first chapter, but I want to kind of go back over it a little bit more slowly now and see what we glean from this first chapter. There is much to know here, much to know and much to understand. First of all, the first thing that we see in this chapter, and I'll just kind of put this back up because we're going to kind of go down through here a little bit. We need to look at the word or the name Theophilus. What is that Theophilus that he's talking about? Now, Theophilus is a Greek word which means friend of God, okay? So there are some Bible scholars that believe that this is simply a salutation. They're just saying, friend of God, he's saying, and he goes on, it's a salutation. Indeed, O friends of God, I made the first report concerning all things which Yeshua began to both do and to teach. Some people believe that this Theophilus, because it was also used as a name, names meant things back then. So some people believe that it was a name, and it could very well have been some very rich entrepreneur type person who was paying Luke to write these things down and paying Luke to actually travel with these apostles and to write these things down and to write this book. So many biblical scholars believe that this was actually someone who was paying Luke to do the work that Luke was doing. And so there's two sides, but the truth of it is there's not enough evidence either way for us to know for sure. So that's where we pretty much have to leave it. It was either just a salutation, friends of God, or it was a name of someone who was paying Luke to write these things down. So I just wanted to kind of get through that. We have a lot of questions on who Theophilus is and what is Theophilus. And that's the story on Theophilus. Now, in verse 2, we want to take a look at Luke and how he already begins making the connection between Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, and the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. And this, again, we talked a little bit about this in the introduction of the book of Acts. The Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh, is mentioned 88 times in the New Testament, 88 times. Now, in the book of Acts, the one book of Acts, it's mentioned 40 of those 88 times in the book of Acts. And if you include the book of Luke, which you should, because the book of Luke and the book of Acts were one books, we're talking about 53 times the Holy Spirit is mentioned. So out of 88 times in the whole New Testament that the Holy Spirit is mentioned, we find that 53 times of them were in the writings of the apostle, or not the apostle, but the physician Luke. Remember, Luke was not an apostle. He was simply a physician that traveled along with the apostle Paul. So very interesting, and we're going to see the real underpinnings of this Holy Spirit. What is the Holy Spirit? What does it do? What power was Yeshua speaking to them about that they would gain through this Holy Spirit? And this is imperative that we understand this according to what Luke is trying to tell us. So I want us to make no mistake. Now, it says that Yeshua appeared to the apostles. I want us to know and understand, as he was with them those 40 days, he was not in the form of a mirage or a ghost, okay? And to prove that, I want to take you to Matthew 28:8. Okay, so we're going to go to Matthew 28:8, and what do we see here? It says, "And going away from the tomb quickly with fear and great joy, they ran to report to his disciples. But as they were going to report to his disciples, behold, Yeshua also met them, saying, 'Peace unto you.' And coming near, they grabbed his feet and they worshiped him." So you could actually grab him, touch him, feel him. Doubting Thomas felt where he was scourged in his side. He let him put his hands into his rib cage. He had the scars still. So the body that he was actually crucified on, he was in that body. And he actually asked them for something to eat. And you actually see Yeshua actually eating with them. So I want to make no mistake about this. He was not a ghost. He was not an apparition. It was him who was there. And we know that through these different writings. So now I want us to move down just a little bit farther. We're going to go down to the 28th verse down here. And let's read through this, speaking about baptism now. It says, "But the 11 disciples went into Galilee to the mount where Yeshua appointed them. And seeing him, they worshipped him. But some of them doubted. And coming up, Yeshua talked with them, saying, 'All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Then, having gone, disciple all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things, whatever I command you. And behold, I am with you all the days until the completion of the age." Now, I want to talk a little bit about this baptism, but I also want to talk a little bit about this 40-day time period that Yeshua was with the apostles. And I want to tie this nice and neatly into the Old Testament, the Torah. Our Father, our Elohim, Yahweh our God, is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. He does not change. He never changes. Everything that he does is always the same. He's not going to change his mind. He's not going to change hats. He doesn't do those things. He's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. And we're going to see that. I want you to take a look at this very this little bit of a flow chart here that I have created for you. Let's see here. This is going to be, yes, right here. Let's take a look at this. Now, I want us to understand the time procession and how it works here. We know Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John all agree, all of them agree, that Yeshua did not die on Good Friday. There's no such thing as Good Friday. Just get it out of your mind. There's no such thing. He died on Passover Day. It was known as Preparation Day, according to all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Read it for yourself. Preparation Day was Passover. That was in preparation for the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which was the day right after Passover. Now, I don't have the Feast of Unleavened Bread in this chart, but it is the day right after Passover. This is why that the apostles had to get Yeshua off the cross and get him into the tomb, because the next day the Feast of Unleavened Bread was beginning, and that was what they called a high Sabbath. There was no work to be done on the first day of Unleavened Bread, and there's no work to be done in the last day of unleavened bread. And you can read that in the book of Leviticus. So we can know and understand that this is how the procession worked. Our Messiah died on Passover Day, according to all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So listen to this now. He dies on Passover Day. He's in the grave for 3 days and three nights, just as he prophesied that he would be. Now, what's 3 days and three nights? What else was 3 days and three nights? Well, we can see that Jonah was in the belly of the whale for how long? 3 days and three nights. Okay, now what did our Messiah say? Let me shrink this and get this out of the way. And I want to take you over to Matthew 12:40 very quickly here. Let me show you this. And it says, very quickly here, it says, then some of the scribes, we're going to start up here at 38. We're going to work our way down here very quickly so that you can know why he was in the grave for 3 days and three nights, just as he promised. It says, then some of the scribes and the Pharisees were saying, teacher, we desire to see a sign from you. But answering, he said to them, an evil and adulterous generation seeks a sign, and a sign shall not be given to it except the sign of Jonah the prophet. And even as Jonah was in the belly of the huge fish for 3 days and three nights, so shall the Son of Man be in the heart of the earth for 3 days and for three nights. Okay, now this is according to our Messiah. Okay, so we can understand that he was in the earth for 3 days and three nights. Again, according to the time that Jonah was in the belly. Now, where is the book of Jonah? Where is that at? It's in the Torah. What is our Messiah referencing? The Tanakh, the writing of the prophets, the Tanakh, the Torah and the Tanakh, okay? The Old Testament. And it's imperative that we see this, and we see these references continuously going back to the Torah. Now, I want to bring this back up here for you very quickly here. Let me bring this back up so that you can see this, okay? So, we have the 3 days and the three nights, just as in the book of Jonah. Now, where do we see this 40 days? If you remember correctly, in the book of Exodus, Moses went unto the top of the mountain so that God could open up his mind for how long? 40 days. So, we have Moses at the top of Mount Sinai. He comes up and speaks to God, Yahweh, our Elohim, for 40 days so that Yahweh can open up his mind and so that he can teach him what to go down and tell the Israelites, what to go down and tell his people. And at the same time, we have our Messiah here for 40 days opening up the minds of his apostles, telling them what to go teach his people. Again, our Elohim is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Then we look at the ascension. Then he ascends after the 40 days. And what do we see? 7 days. 7 days. Yahweh rested on the seventh day from the time of creation, the seventh day Sabbath. What happens in the seventh day? Pentecost. And Pentecost happens, and the Holy Spirit is given. And the Holy Spirit, we'll talk a little bit more about that Holy Spirit as we continue on. But I just want us to see these numbers. There is a whole study that you can do mathematically on the Word of God that really will just absolutely blow your mind, and many books have been written about this, and how these numbers are always significant to Yahweh God the Father. Again, 50 days from the beginning of Passover to Pentecost, it was always that way. This is not something that the Christians came up with. The Passover, you count 50 days from the Passover, and that was Pentecost. Now, what did that have to do with the Jews? Many Christians think Pentecost has to do with the giving of the Holy Spirit, and it's a Christian holiday. It is not. It was always. It's a Jewish holiday, or an Israelite holiday called Shavuot. They transliterated it into Pentecost, because it fell on the same day. Shavuot, or Pentecost, was the day that they celebrated Moses coming down the mountain with the Ten Commandments and the law of God. And this was what the Jewish people and the Israelites always celebrated. And they were commanded to celebrate this. So Pentecost is not just some Christian thing where the Holy Spirit was given. Again, we see, and this is so very profound for us to understand. And let me get back here to my notes because I don't want to get too far away. Again, Pentecost, not a new Christian holiday. Pentecost was always kept by the Israelites in commemoration of the giving of the Ten Commandments at Sinai and God's law. So what we're seeing here is a type and shadow of what happened thousands of years ago. Yahweh, or Elohim, gave his law at Sinai when he gave his laws to Moses and wrote his Ten Commandments in stone with his own finger. Now, we find our Elohim returning thousands of years later on the same day to write his laws in our hearts and in our minds. That was the duty of the Holy Spirit. And if you have the Holy Spirit of Yahweh God the Father, you have his laws written in your heart and in your mind. They are no longer written on a piece of paper. They are written in your heart and they're written in your mind. Let's take a look at Jeremiah 31:31. I want to take a look at this prophecy that is being fulfilled on Pentecost. This is a prophecy that Yahweh is fulfilling on the day of Pentecost. Let's take a look at that. I think I can go to E6 here. Let me change this so you can read this with me. This is the new covenant that everyone speaks about. When people say, I'm a new covenant Christian, this is the new covenant. Jeremiah 31:31. Behold, the day is come, says Yahweh, that I will cut a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Now, notice here, the house is always referring to God's people. It's the house of Israel and the house of Judah, because remember, they were split. He says, I'll cut a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I cut with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which covenant of mine they broke, although I was a husband to them, says Yahweh. But this shall be a covenant that I will cut with the house of Israel, the whole of Israel. After those days, declares Yahweh, I will put my Torah in their inward parts, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people. You see, my friends, the new covenant doesn't have anything to do with nailing the Torah and the law of God to a tree somewhere or to some cross. Our Messiah did not come to do away with the law. He tells us that very clearly in Matthew 5:17. Read it for yourself. He says very clearly, I did not come to abolish the law or the prophets. I came to fulfill them, to do them. And he nails it down with the sentence right after that. He says, in fact, he says, not even the crossing of a T or the dotting of an I will pass away from the law until heaven and earth pass away and all is accomplished. My friends, all things are not accomplished and we're still standing on the earth. Excuse me. So we can know and understand that the laws of Yahweh God the Father have not been abolished by Yeshua HaMashiach according to Yeshua HaMashiach. And we, again, this is the new covenant. He, right here it is. It doesn't say that I'm going to just get rid of my laws. It says I'm going to write my Torah in their inward parts. I'm going to write it on their hearts. Okay, let's take a look at Hebrews 10:15. And what does Paul tell us? This is the Apostle Paul. According to many, they believe that Apostle Paul was the one who wrote the book of Hebrew. Let's see what he says. He says, and the Holy Spirit witness to us also, for after having said before, this is the covenant that I will covenant to them after those days, says Yahweh, giving my Torah on their hearts, and I will write them on their minds. Okay, now for those of you who are King James Version, we don't want to leave you out here. Let's go ahead and see exactly what it says here. And let's highlight that as well for you. So you don't, a lot of people have a fit because you don't teach in the King James Version. Trust me, you can take any of these scriptures you like and look at them in the King James Version. They will tell you exactly the same thing. Whereof the Holy Ghost is also is a witness to us, for after that he said before, This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their hearts, and in their minds I will write them. My friends, are God's laws written in your heart and in your mind, or are they nailed to some tree somewhere? Again, Christian academia lost. So we need to know these things, and we need to be able to put these things together. This is exactly what the Holy Spirit was given to us to do. And those of us who have the Holy Spirit know and understand this very, very well. What is the biblical definition of the love of God? For this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments, and His commandments are not burdensome. Now, if they're not burdensome, they can't be works, can they, my friends? Think about that for just a moment. Okay, now we're going to let that lie a little bit, and we're going to continue on. All of this will come to fruition, and you'll see this over and over, time and time again, as we move forward. I know this is new information to many of you. In Acts 5, okay, let's take a look. Let's go back and take a look at Acts 5. We're just kind of moving down the chapter here very quickly. Acts 5, we find that he says, John the Baptist indeed baptized in water, but you will be baptized in the Holy Spirit. So the English word baptized comes from the Greek word baptizium. Okay, now this means to immerse. That's what it means. In fact, it was often used in regards to dyeing cloth, where they would take a cloth and they would put it into a vat of dye, and then that cloth, as it came out, would take on the attributes of the color of that dye. And that's where it was often used. Now, what does it mean to baptize someone? And is water involved? How many times have you seen this denomination and that denomination sprinkling and doing all of these kinds of things to babies and all of that? Is that written in Scripture anywhere? Let's take a look and let's see what we can glean and what we can understand from the written Scripture. It said, now, during the Second Temple period, Judaism knew baptism, which is exactly what John came doing, baptizing, immersing people, bringing them back up, okay, out of the water. Baptism was often used to purify oneself. It was a way of becoming ritually purified. Now, I'm going to show you a picture of a mikvah. This is a mikvah that they used to use. And even still today, Messianic Jews who believe in the Messiah will not use the word baptized. They will use the word mikvah. Have you been mikvahed? That means, have you been baptized, okay? So that's the term that they use. This was a mikvah. You would go down into, and some of them were very large, some of them very small. You could also use a river as John did, okay, or a lake or whatnot, living waters. Many people like to be baptized in living waters. So this was a Jewish mikvah, and you would go into the mikvah. They would put you down under the mikvah, under the water, and raise you back up, and you were ritualistically clean. Now, I want to talk a little bit about this. Some people will tell you in some denominational charters that you do not need to be baptized. They will tell you that it is legalism and that you do not need to. That's works and you don't need to do it. Well, I want to take you over to John 3:5 very quickly, and I want us to take a look at John 3:5. So let's go over to John 3:5. Here it is. Yeshua answered, truly, truly, I say to you, that if a man is not born from water and spirit, he is not able to enter the kingdom of Yahweh. He is not able to enter the kingdom of heaven. Do you understand? If you're not born from both water and spirit, you will not enter the kingdom of Yahweh. It's just that simple. Let's take a look at another scripture here very quickly. And we'll take a look at Acts 2:38. What does it say in Acts 2:38? And I'll take us over here to the English Standard Version. And then what does he say here? I got that highlighted already. It says, and Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you and for your children, and all who are far off, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to himself. And with many other words, he bore witness and continued to exhort them, saying, Save yourselves from this crooked generation. What does Peter say? Repent and do what? Be baptized. What does our Messiah say? Go and baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let's take a look at this last one, Acts 8:35. Now, this is an actual act of Philip. Okay, and let's take a look at that very quickly. I have that down here. Now, Philip, this is where Philip baptizes the eunuch. Listen to this now. Acts 8:35. Then Philip opened his mouth, and beginning with the scripture, he told him the good news about Jesus. And as they were going along the road, they came to some water. And the eunuch said, See, here is water. What prevents me from being baptized? And he commanded the chariot to stop, and they both went down into the water, Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him, or mikvahed him. And when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord carried Philip away, and the eunuch saw him no more, and he went on his way rejoicing. So you just can't get out of it, my friends. People will make up things. They will lie to you. They will twist the writings of the Apostle Paul to their own destruction, as they do the other scriptures. We can know fully well and understand that baptism is not an option. It is a commandment. Don't let anyone lie to you and tell you any different. Now, as it was always known throughout Judaism, it is known that one was not ritually pure. And if you weren't ritually pure, then you could not be used by Yahweh, our Elohim. So, for one to become ritually pure, a mikvah was used to completely immerse that person. And again, we find that this in itself is a shadow of things to come. And that's why John came baptizing. This was what was going to be used to signify people laying down in the water in the grave with Messiah. What are we supposed to do? We're supposed to follow him, do as he did. You lay down into the water in the grave, and you come back up a new person, a new creation, a spirit-filled follower of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, who has the laws of God written in his heart and in his mind, or her heart and her mind. Okay, this is what baptism is all about. So we need to know and understand this, and we need to be able to show others that this is what this is about. What a mikvah or a baptism, same thing. Baptism is the Greek word for the Hebrew word mikvah. Okay. So, and I want to take us very quickly. Let's go to 1 John 5:3 because I don't want anybody to get lost here. Any of you who have ever heard me speak, I speak about 1 John 5:3 everywhere I go. 1 John 5:3, because this is the biblical definition of the love of God. Can we read this? Can we just read this? The biblical definition of the love of God, 1 John 5:3, for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. For everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world, and this is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Who is it that overcomes the world except the one who believes that Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, is the Son of God? Okay? If you don't believe and you haven't been baptized and you don't have the Holy Spirit, then you are not part of Yahweh's family. You are not part of the olive tree. You are not part of the body of Yeshua HaMashiach. We need to know this and understand this. Let's go to 1 John 2:3 very quickly, and I want you to see this. 1 John 2:3 says this. It says, And by this we know that we have come to know him, if we keep his commandments. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments, is what? A liar. A liar. And the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this, we may know that we are in him. Now, one more. I want to go to John 14:15. Let's just really drive this home. John 14:15. What does it say? It says, this is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, red letter words, his own breath, his own tongue, his own words. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper, the Holy Spirit, to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world, get this now, whom the world cannot receive. Why? Because it neither sees him nor knows him. Talking about the Holy Spirit, the Ruach HaKodesh. You know him, he says, but you know him, for he dwells in you and will be with you. He says, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. Oh, but that's works, Pastor. I don't have to do works. I can do whatever I want. That's I've been bought and paid for, and I can do whatever I want now. I'm once saved, always saved. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And it says that he tells us very clearly. He says, I'll send you a helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot see, because it neither sees him nor knows him. The world cannot see the Ruach HaKodesh. They cannot see him. They don't know anything about him. They know nothing about him. Why? Because they have, the ignorant and the unstable, have twisted the writings of Paul to their own destruction. And they believe that if you still believe that you still are accountable and that there is an obedience to faith, that you are legalistic, you see. You're legalistic. There's no works involved. What does James say? The book of James says, so the body apart from the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. According to James, the brother of Yeshua HaMashiach, who was the head of the Jerusalem council in Jerusalem, who even Paul took his discrepancies to. Starting to get the word, the wheels to go around. I'm praying. Now, before we move on, let me be perfectly clear. Baptism, once again, not optional. It is indeed commanded. And again, John 3:5, Yeshua answered, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you are born again of both the water and the Spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. And this is extremely important for us to know and understand. Now, this is not the first time that we hear of the Ruach HaKodesh. Now, I want a lot of people to know and understand that, you know, the Holy Spirit, that doesn't come into play until the New Testament, right? Wrong. The Holy Spirit is mentioned all through the Old Testament and from through the Torah. Let's go to Numbers. I want to go to Numbers 11:24. Hold on here just a second. Let me get us over there. Numbers 11:24. And let's go down here. What does this say? Now, I want you to listen to this. So Moses went out, and he told the people the words of the Lord. And he gathered 70 men from the elders of the people and placed them around the tent. Then the Lord came down, how? In a cloud, okay, and spoke to him and took some of the spirit that was on him and put it on the 70 elders. And as soon as the spirit rested on them, they prophesied. But they did not continue doing it. Now, two men remain in the camp, one named Eldad and the other named Medad, and the Spirit rested on them. They were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent, and so they prophesied in the camp. So this is the first time that we see, one of the first times that we see the Ruach, the Spirit of God resting on people. Now notice here, that the Spirit did not infill them. It simply rested on them, and this was a very short-lived period of time in which they prophesied. So I want us to just know this and know and understand that there is nothing new under the sun. Our God, Yahweh, our Elohim, the same yesterday, today, you got it, and tomorrow. And we see that all through, and we see these manifestations of things coming to fruition here in the book of Acts, things that have happened in the past, again, repeating themselves, coming to full fruition here in the book of Acts. Okay, now the first mediator was Moses, and it was on his 70 elders that the Ruach, or the Holy Spirit, rested. But again, it was short-lived, and it did not dwell within them. It simply rested on them. Once again, my friends, we see the fulfillment of the Torah being fulfilled in the New Testament and in the book of Acts. Now, I want us to notice something else in the book of Acts. Let's go to Acts 1:6. I want to take us back to Acts 1:6. Okay? 1:6. It says, "So when they come together, they asked him, 'Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?'" Now, I want you to understand something about this. You see, the apostles were waiting for a Messiah who was prophesied to come from the house of David, who would restore the kingdom back to Yahweh or Elohim and rescue them from the Roman Empire. This is what they were looking for. This is what they thought that the Messiah was there to do. And they knew that it was only through David's son, Solomon. It had to come through the seed of David, and the only one to get, that it could come through is through Solomon, and that this Messiah would come. Well, they knew that Yeshua was part of that bloodline. And so they were anxious about when the time for a revolt against the Romans would come, thinking that Yeshua was going to be the one that was going to lead them to freedom, and he was going to take back the earth again, and he was going to come to dwell among them as he did back during the Exodus days. But Yeshua had something different in mind, and he knew that his mission was not complete yet. He had to complete the work on the cross in order to join the two sticks of Ezekiel back together in one stick in the hand of Yahweh or Elohim, and to save the lost sheep of Israel so that they could once again come back to their groom. So he wanted to bring the northern and the southern kingdom back together again to make one Israel, not two, one olive tree, as we see in the 11th chapter of the book of Romans. You can read all about it. No one understand who the olive tree is. No one understand who the branches are. No one understand who the root is. And again, you can find that in chapter 11 of Romans. We did a study on that. You can also find that at holyimpactministries.com. Just go to our Bible studies and look for the 11th chapter. So this is what he came to do, so that the rest of the world could be grafted into the family of Yahweh God the Father, into that olive tree, into the olive tree. And we need to know, we need to understand these things. That's what he came to do. And he even says, "I was sent for the lost sheep of Israel." And we'll get more into that, and we'll prove that out as we go through this study. So I just want to continue on here. Where was I here? Okay, we who read and study the scripture know and understand that Jerusalem will be the new kingdom. If we read the book of Revelation, we already know this. It will be the new heaven. And if you, again, once again, if you read the book of Revelations, we know that the Jerusalem will be the capital of the world. It will be the seat of Yahweh God, our Father in heaven, our Elohim. And it will be Yeshua who rules and reigns with an iron rod. He will smash these nations like clay pots. And that day is coming, and we are closer to it now than when we first believed, my friends. So we can know and we can understand that. He will rule and he will reign from that time. And again, it is closer than when we first believed. The New Testament is still in progress as we speak. So just as our Messiah instructed his apostles back in his day, we need to carry out the work of expanding the coming kingdom. And yes, we will hear of wars and rumors of wars and kingdoms rising against kingdoms and famines and plagues and all of these things. But we need not let these things hinder us. There is work to do. There is work to do. We are told in the 12th chapter of Luke 56 and the 56th verse not to be hypocrites, and not to, so that we're not able to interpret the times that we live in. Let's take a look at 1 Thessalonians 5:2. I want to take a look at 1 Thessalonians 5:2 here very quickly while we're on this subject. 1 Thessalonians 5:2. He says, "For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night." Now, usually this is what you hear most Christians saying. Oh, he's going to come like a thief in the night, so who cares? You're never going to know what day it is. It says no, and not even the angels know the day or the hour. Well, listen to what he says and see if you agree. Let's repeat that again. 1 Thessalonians 5:2. "For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman, a woman, and they will not escape. But listen to this now. But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of the light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us be awake and sober. And again, if we take a look at Luke 12, and I just want to show you this very quickly, Luke 12, 56, what does our Messiah say? He says, you hypocrites. He says, you know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and sky, but why do you not know how to interpret the present time that you're living in? And why do you not judge for yourselves what is right? So we can see we are commanded to be on alert, to be watching. And this is not going to be a surprise for us. We know the time is near. We know it is very, very near. But that does not negate the work that we need to do. There's always going to be a new video out. There's always going to be a new sign in the sun, moon, and stars. There's always going to be a new asteroid, a new sinkhole, a new war, a new plague. These things are going to come. We know they're going to come. And that's what he's saying in 1 Thessalonians. You, my brothers, are not asleep as the others are. So this isn't going to come to you as a surprise. But to the world, I will come like a thief in the night. He's talking about the rest of the world who does not know him because they do not know his Holy Spirit. They do not know who he even is. Many will come to him and say, Lord, Lord, he said, have we not done great miracles in your name? And haven't we done many miracles in your name? And he's going to say, I never knew you. Get away from me, you who are lawless. That day is going to come and many are going to have a rude awakening because they have chosen to listen to some man standing behind a pulpit without ever checking his fruits to see whether his fruit be good or rotten. And the only way that we can test a man's fruit, my friends, is to read the scripture and to know how to identify him. This is what it says, 1 Timothy in closing. We're getting down to the end here. I just want to take you over to 1 Timothy 6:20. Let's take a look at 1 Timothy 6:20. And this is what we find. It says, this is Paul again. He says, O Timothy, guard the deposit entrusted to you. Guard the deposit entrusted to you. Avoid irreverent babble and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. For by professing it, some have swerved from the faith. Grace be with you. He says, guard your faith. Guard your salvation. Guard the truth of the gospel. Guard it, he says. Guard it. Avoid irreverent babble with contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. Many of these men coming out of seminary schools and Bible colleges and all of these denominationally owned colleges and school buildings telling you that all of God's laws have been nailed to the cross, once saved, always saved, pre-tribulation rescue, all of these things, my friends, and they can't find them in the scriptures. And the Bible tells us very clearly, he who says he knows him and does not keep his commandments is a liar and the truth is not in him. Is that man keeping the seventh-day Sabbath of God? Is that man keeping the Passover? Is that man keeping the feast days, the appointments of God? Or is he still playing around with fat men and magical reindeer and divination and Easter bunnies that lay eggs and Good Friday and Advent and Lent and all of this man-made, man-created trash that's not found anywhere in the scriptures? This, my friends, is what we must be on guard about. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 16 very quickly. 1 Corinthians, and we want to go to 16:13. And what does it say here? 13 and 14. Be watchful, stand firm in the faith. Act like men, be strong. Let all that you do be done in love. Be strong, guard the faith, he says. Guard the faith. Let's take a look at Jude 1 and 3. We're just going to fire through these very quickly. Jude 1, verse 3. What does he say? Beloved, although I was very eager to write to you about your common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, appealing to you to contend for the faith that was once and for all delivered to the saints. Contend for the faith. Guard the faith. do we hear what he is trying to tell us so very desperately? Are we guarding the faith? Are we contending for the faith? Are we sticking to the scriptures? Do we understand the biblical definition of the obedience of faith that Paul talks about in the first chapter of the book of Romans? Do we know and understand the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, and what it is that he has given? Do we know that God's laws are written in our hearts and our minds according to the new covenant found in the book of Jeremiah and in the book of Hebrews, both in the New and the Old Testaments? Do we know this? Has anyone ever shared this information with us? Have we ever read it before? Are we familiar with it? My friends, I want us to read one thing before we leave. One thing before we leave. And then we will come back with part two of chapter one. And if you think this has a lot of information, wait until you see the depth of what you're actually reading in chapter one. This is coming up in chapter two. Matthew 13:13. I want to take you there very quickly. Matthew 13:13. And I want you to hear this, my friends, because it's important. He says this is our Messiah. He says, this is why I speak to them in parables. He's telling us, why does he speak to people in parables? Why does he make it so hard to understand? Because seeing they do not see, and hearing they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled that says, you will indeed hear, but never understand. You will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull. And with their eyes, they can with their ears, they can barely hear, and with their eyes, they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and blessed are your ears, for they hear. For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear but did not hear it. My friends, I just want to say this to you. I want to say thank you so very much for spending your time with us here on this Bible study. The book of Acts is immensely important to understand, and we must keep it in the proper context. And we go through great lengths to try to help you understand that the book of Acts is not a book that stands on its own. It is not alone. You need the rest of the book to understand the rest of the story. We'd like to invite you for part two of chapter one, when we get into the depth of what chapter one is saying, things that you probably did not see at first glance reading through chapter one, but you will be amazed at learning, I assure you. So we'd like to invite you back for part two of chapter one. In the meantime, I'm Pastor Scott Blaine with HolyImpactMinistries.com. My hope and my prayer is that the grace and the peace of God would be with you, and the hand of Yahweh God our Elohim would be upon you to keep you safe. Until we meet again, God bless and shalom.
If you were blessed by this teaching, please consider helping us reach the nations by making a donation today. Thank you and shalom.